Tonight's topic is a very unusual one. It's about dibukim and ruchot. For those of you who do not know what dibukim means, it is a spirit that possesses somebody, that enters the body of someone else. It's called a dibuk. In English, it's called possession. You may have heard of exorcism, the exorcist. That has to do with the spirit that invades the body of those who are still alive. And ruchot are ghosts. I decided to speak about the two together, even though some of the ideas that you may hear, you may have heard in the past too, because we have spoken about similar topics. We have spoken about death in itself, near-death experience, those who have died before their time. We've spoken about the various parts of the neshama, the soul. So we've spoken about what the spirit is exactly. We've spoken about the topic of Gan Eden and Gehenom, reincarnation, the meaning of pain and suffering in one's life. So there may be some common ideas interspersed in these various lectures that we've already covered. Nevertheless, tonight, of course, the topic stands out on its own because this is a very unusual situation, a very unusual symptom when a spirit actually invades another body. And that's called in Hebrew a dibuk. And I'm going to describe what this is exactly. But before I tell you a little bit about how this happens, I want to give you a small introduction about all these topics in general. Many people would call these paranormal. Paranormal means it's not your typical normal situation that you can prove, that you can observe, that you can explain scientifically. In the past, however, years ago, in almost any culture, these things were quite more common. People were always curious about the area that was metaphysical in nature. Metaphysical. People are always curious, but nevertheless, because of the nature of many of this phenomena, not very many people were intimately familiar with all its details, but they were aware, whether it's in Japan or in India or in Israel, in Africa, and even in America. No matter how ignorant they were still aware that there are spiritual entities. There is a spirit, there is a ghost, there are demons. And that's another topic we spoke about, demons and angels. So, what has happened? That in the past, people have believed in this, people accepted this. And today, people actually ridicule this. They make fun. They look at it as paranormal, something that is not explainable, at the very least. But they don't have a good explanation for it. They'd like to say that people make up stories, that it's untrue. It's very easy to say that. But what has happened really is that in the past 150 years or so, the Western culture especially has become much more materialistic. There is more of a dagesh, more of an emphasis on materialism. And because of that, people have begun to doubt anything which comes close to spiritual. This has become a materialistic world, right? Science and the like. And because of that, anything which is materialistic, anything which is spiritual, is really not easily accepted. However, in the Kabbalah, this is discussed at length. And it begins with understanding what happens to the human being after he dies. It is not a simple matter. As I've explained in the past, death is not the cessation of all existence. All death is, all it represents, is the cessation of the physical existence, as we know it to be, where the physical body rots in the grave. That's all death is. Where the soul, the essence of the human being, departs from this world and goes into another, let's call it dimension. Okay? Let's call it another dimension, even though we know it's another realm, it's another world. But the soul is still around. And what happens to the soul is very interesting, because there are various stages that the soul actually needs to go through before it eventually gets to what we call its final resting place. Makom Menuchato. Final resting place. From the death until the soul gets to its final resting place may be a long journey. So as I was saying, the Kabbalah explains a little bit more the various stages that the neshama, the soul, is going to go through until it reaches its final resting place. People are accustomed to believing that there's only two directions when you leave this world. There's either Gan Eden or Gehenom. They've heard of paradise, they've heard of hell, and that's it. You either go right or you go left. They don't realize that there's much more than just right and left. There's something even in between. And that's called Kafakela. One of those places is called Kafakela. Literally is translated in English as the slingshot. A slingshot because the soul, in a way, is being thrown from one end of the world to the other end. And is being pursued by certain angelic beings, by certain demons as well. And it does not have any peace while it is in the Kafakela. And before we get to a deeper understanding of why this needs to happen, why he doesn't go to his final resting place, we need to keep in mind that what immediately happens after the departure of the soul from this world is a mishpat, is a judgment. It's not that you die and then you just go somewhere. There is a mishpat. We are accountable for our deeds. Life requires certain responsibilities. We're not here just for a ride or to go play golf. Right? We're here with a mission. Whether you're Jewish or not makes no difference. Our missions are different depending on if you're Jewish or not, depending on if you're a man or a woman and so forth. But in the end, we're all human beings created in the image of God, which means we're special and we're here for a purpose. So the first stage, right after one's death, besides what happens in the physical world, which is the burial, the funeral, and the like, is judgment. And the Zohar says there are seven judgments. In other words, in the judgment process itself, there are seven steps. There is the judgment of one's deeds as the soul leaves the body. At the time of Yetziyat HaNeshama, there is already judgment. Everything that has been done and said by this individual is recorded. As he's being led at the funeral, as he's being led to be buried, there's also another step or another stage in the judgment where they call out, these are the deeds, this is what he accomplished, or this is what he did if it's negative. It's being called out. As he's being led and being put into the grave, there is another judgment in describing what he has done. And finally, when he's in the grave, step number four, there's another judgment, part of which it's called in the Kabbalah, Hibuta Kever. Another stage in the judgment. Then there's the judgment of the corpse itself, as it is consumed by worms. That is also painful, even though the physical body no longer feels the pain because it's dead. But the neshama is pained to see how the body is decomposing. That in itself is also a stage in the judgment. That doesn't last too long, obviously, until the body rots. Then there is number six, Gehenom, if that applies. And then there's number seven, if it applies, Kafakela, as we called it, the slingshot. So, what is the slingshot? What's so unique about the slingshot, the Kafakela? Many people think Gehenom is the worst. It's not the worst. All Gehenom is, if I may describe it so, is a hot shower. Relatively speaking, I mean, it's a lot more than a hot shower. According to the Kabbalah, there are even various levels in Gehenom, various medurot, various departments, for different lengths of time. But really the worst of all, according to the Kabbalah, is Kafakela. Because Kafakela can go on for hundreds of years sometimes. Kafakela means that the neshama has no rest. It is a wandering soul. It is so bad, it must have done something so terribly wrong that they don't even give it permission to go to Gehenom. That's how bad it is. Only after it is done with Kafakela will they allow it to go into Gehenom. And only after Gehenom do they allow it, if necessary, to come back Begilgul in a reincarnation. Reincarnation is the easiest of all, because you come back, you live your life again. It may be a comfortable life, but you have to go through diapers and school and high school and so forth and marriage and everything again. But it's still a tikkun. It's still something that the neshama can gain from by coming down and being given a second chance to undo or to fix what it did wrong last time, or to accomplish that which it is lacking, that which it needed to accomplish in the previous lifetime. In the meantime, as this neshama is wandering without any rest in the kafakela, as I said before, it is being pursued by demons, by certain types of destructive angels. It is a very painful experience because it is without rest, except for Shabbat in some situations, where they don't pursue that soul anymore. That is one situation. But the one that we're going to be talking about is a unique situation where this neshama that is being pursued by these demons and angelic beings at times is allowed to enter the body of a living soul, in other words, a human being, man or woman, or a child, and possess them. In other words, to be in them as though they're living in the body of another human being. At the time when they do enter another human being's body, they have menucha. They have some sort of physical rest. From what? From those that are pursuing them, from those demons, from those malevolent angels, if we can call them, that are pursuing this soul. This is not their ultimate stop. This is not a real resting place, but it's better than being pursued. And this is, of course, meant for a limited amount of time only. The reason why it's called the Dibuk in Hebrew is because the moment it enters and possesses the body, it takes control. When we talk about possession, we're talking about taking control. And the person who's being possessed almost has no control, except at certain times of the day or night, perhaps, it acts normal. It acts itself. But when the soul, the other foreign soul, is acting up, then it completely loses control. In other words, the human being who's being possessed completely loses control. How do you detect if somebody has a dibuk? I mean, we may not know 100% if somebody is possessed, but there are various symptoms that will give it away. If you notice the symptoms, you may be seeing somebody who is possessed. One of them is that all of a sudden it experiences seizures. Everybody know here what seizures are? Like epilepsy. All of a sudden, even though he was never known to have this problem before. Number two, swelling different parts of his body, an unusual kind of swelling. First the arm, then the leg, then the thigh. That swelling moves around to different parts of the body. Sometimes there are feelings of being strangled. That's another one. The eyes roll from time to time. But the one that really gives it away, that you know for sure that this is a dibuk, is when all of a sudden you hear a strange voice. Not the voice of the girl, the man, the woman. The voice of somebody else. Totally somebody else coming out, not from the mouth, but from the stomach. The tongue barely moves. So we know that the vocal cords here are not doing the talking. It's coming from the stomach. You can see sometimes the stomach going up and down. Now this has been observed, all of what I'm talking about has been observed from time to time. Many countries, in many cultures, this can happen to goyim as well as to Jews. It's something that happens. Dibuk. What are these dibukim trying to accomplish other than getting some rest from these angels that are pursuing them? They're really searching for a tikkun. In the end, what they want is somebody to help them. they're stuck in this Kafa killer for perhaps many, many years, and they need help. Yes, those who have left this world can no longer do anything for themselves, and in some ways they depend on those who are still alive for some help. How were they able to enter this human body? Who gave them permission? Of course, they were given, in order to be able to invade and possess another person's body, they had to have been given permission by those who watch over them. And that individual who's being possessed, in order for him to be possessed, obviously did something to deserve being possessed. Otherwise, they don't have permission. Nobody has any, no other soul just has permission to enter somebody else's body to cause him all this pain. So obviously they must have done something, and I'm going to share with you a story or two of how we see this. A lot of dibukim remain anonymously. Remain anonymous. In other words, we never hear about them. They keep quiet. They barely hurt the individual they're possessing. You will barely notice that anything is wrong. They want to keep a low profile. Why? They don't want to be kicked out. Who's going to kick them out? Who's going to exorcise them? In other words, who's going to remove them? It used to be that big tzaddikim and Kabbalists who knew how to do it, only they would approach this kind of a situation because it can be dangerous. A dibuk can be dangerous. It can harm other people who are present in the room. And therefore, those who approach this matter to try to remove the soul, the spirit, from the body of the human being, usually knew what they were doing before they began to even attempt to do something. Now, what happened in all these stories, in all these cases, was whether it was removed or not, what always used to happen is that it became clear, became evident to all who were present, sheyesh din veyesh dayan, that there is a judge and there is judgment, sheyesh sachar va'onish, that there is reward and punishment. I mean, anybody who was a non-believer, when he entered that room, when he observed something like that, he came away shaken very, very much. Hey, this is real. There is a neshama. There's something after death. There's something that continues on even later after death. It doesn't just stop with death. And they're actually in pain. In other words, we're actually accountable for what we do. So all of a sudden, this incident was a tremendous chizuk, as we say in Hebrew. It strengthened people's faith, and it really shocked them into, you know, realizing that they better be careful with their actions while they're still alive. Now, since a lot of these dibukim remain anonymous, I have some news to tell you. It is very possible that many people today who have some mental problems, who are emotionally disturbed in some way, in reality, it's not an illness that they have, but it could be they're possessed. A lot of people who are institutionalized for what we think is some extreme form of schizophrenia can really be a dibuk that has not been properly diagnosed. I'm not saying all, and I'm not saying for sure, but it's quite possible. Because after all, we did say that many remain anonymous. They don't talk. You know, how are we going to know? And especially for people who don't believe in these things, how are they going to diagnose it? But it's very possible that many types of illnesses really are not illnesses, but indicative of the presence of a dibuk. I'm going to get to that. Now, for those who want a little bit more information and many, many stories, I would recommend a book called Minchat Yehuda, written by Rabbi Yehuda Fataya, who was one of the chief rabbis in Baghdad not too long ago, in the beginning of the 20th century. He actually had many such cases where he was involved. He spoke to them. He took care of them. Incredible stories, incredible amount of information, details about what goes on with these people in the afterlife. Minchat Yehuda, it's not available in English. It's in Hebrew. And there's some of it, it was also in Arabic. And for those of you who understand it, I highly recommend it. It does shed a lot of light about this particular phenomena that we call dibukim, ruchot, and the like. But I'm going to share with you a story that happened also recently. There are actually various incidents that occurred in the past 100 years. One was with the Chafetz Chaim, famous story with the Chafetz Chaim, where he was indirectly involved with it. But the one that is more interesting and perhaps even a little bit more recent, I think, is one that the couple who went through the situation actually eventually moved to Israel. And maybe I'll talk to you a little bit about that particular incident, because otherwise I can tell you story after story. There was a young couple who got married, and it was understood that the young man would be learning Torah for a while, and what would be used to support him was the father-in-law plus the dowry. And that was going to go on for a number of years. But as things happened, unfortunately, the father-in-law lost his source of income, and all that was left was the dowry. And the couple, of course, didn't want to use their dowry just to continue learning. This was an opportunity to start thinking about another source of income. And the young woman decided to use part of that dowry to open up a business. And she says, I know you're learning Torah, but I will need your help for 2 hours a day at the store. So he started off learning and helping her 2 hours a day. After a while, however, that 2 hours became 4 hours, and eventually 6 hours, and eventually the entire day this man was helping his wife at the shop, and no more learning Torah. That means he moved away from the Torah. And he was a learned man. I mean, he was capable of learning Torah. Not a very good thing, but it happens. One day, this young woman started feeling that she's choking and was not feeling well at all. Something very, very strange was happening with her. They didn't know what it was. They took her to the best doctors. They eventually took her to Vienna. It was a faraway city, to see what the doctors say there. Nobody could figure out what it is. Until there were rumors. Rumors started spreading, maybe this is a dibuk. And sure enough, they took her to a big Kabbalist, and the Kabbalist knew how to get this dibuk, if in fact it was a dibuk, to talk. And sure enough, all of a sudden, they heard a voice. Said, oh, it is a dibuk. Now we know what it is. The dibuk began to speak. So the Kabbalist asked him, who are you? He says, I'm a young man. Well, I was a young man in a previous life. I died a few years ago, he said, in an accident in Africa. He says, what were you doing in Africa? He says, I was a Bachur Yeshiva, but eventually I made the mistake of leaving the Yeshiva and going out with friends who convinced me to do business, and business took me to Africa. And as a result of leaving the yeshiva world and going into business, I became less and less observant, less religious, and committed all the avirot in the Torah, just about. And one day, as I was traveling in Africa, I fell off a wagon and got killed. That's the story. And ever since, I have no peace, no rest. They're pursuing me. He has no peace, no rest. So the rabbi asked him, didn't you have a chance to do teshuvah before you died? He says, no. It happened so quickly, his death, that he did not even have a chance to regret and to do teshuvah. And now I'm stuck in this way, and I have no peace. So the Kabbalist asks, okay, I understand your situation, but what is it your business to enter the body of this young woman? What did she do wrong? So he says, he starts laughing. The spirits, the evil spirits, they still have a little bit of their nature that they had while they were alive. So he used to laugh. He used to make jokes. He used to have a very bad mouth, a filthy mouth. So that nature came out again. So he was thinking in a very filthy way, in a very low way. And he was saying, this girl deserves it. Her mother and her mother-in-law actually begged me. Those two already are no longer alive. Her mother and her mother-in-law. They actually begged me to enter her body and to bring about this pain to her. She deserves it because she took away her husband from learning Torah. He was learning Torah, and because of her, she took her husband away from Torah, if that's what it's coming to her. And if I would not enter her body, she would have committed such a great sin that she would have had a very, very difficult time when she will leave this world. In other words, it's for her good that he entered the body. So the Kabbalists decided, okay, enough. She suffered enough. You've suffered too. Let's try to resolve the situation. What will you want for you to leave the body? A tikkun. What kind of a tikkun do you want for your soul? That somebody should say Kaddish for me for at least a week? They should learn Mishnayot and so forth. He gave various instructions as to what he would like and who should do it for him. And then he asked the soul, okay, fine. Are you ready to leave? He says, I will leave tonight. And at that evening, the young woman started, you know, having all sorts of pain from different parts of her body. And at the end, that soul that was possessing her came out of her fingernail, because they saw the fingernail all of a sudden fall off, and then all of a sudden they heard a window break and they saw a small little hole in the window. So that's actually from the fingernail, whether it's the hand or the foot, it's the least painful place for the soul to depart, because wherever the soul, the possessing soul, departs from, that particular area becomes almost dead. So it was actually the best place for it to leave from, causing the least amount of damage. Left from between the nail and the flesh, and broke through a window. And that's how they knew. At the time the soul was leaving, everybody who was outside heard a scream, somebody screaming out loud. It was the soul. Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. That was the end of that. The couple eventually moved to Israel, and they took along that window as proof, as a souvenir of that episode. This is just one of many such stories that are many of them are very similar, actually, in what goes on and what happened. But what we see from this also is that the individual who has no rest, who's being pursued, and this could be for a number of years, not 12 months like Gehenom, but for a number of years in the Kafakela, must have done something terribly wrong, terrible, to deserve this kind of punishment, that they don't even let him into Gehenom. He first has to go through this kind of a situation before he gets to Gehenom, and before he even gets to his final resting place. Many of you here possibly have heard of a more recent book story that happened in Israel, about 10 years ago, maybe actually less. With a woman in Dimona who had a similar situation. I'm not going to get into all the details of that story. Many people still think it's not true. I think she's said to have denied it. But as far as I know from all the information that I've looked into and investigated, that was a real story. It was not made up or anything. What happened did in fact happen. But people have a question. The question is, they say, it is only rumored, I haven't seen it written, that the Chafetz Chaim, who himself was aware of the book that I mentioned, said that before Mashiach comes, there will no longer be such stories. And obviously, whenever somebody sees something like this, it could interfere with his free will. So perhaps, when he said that these things will not be that common before Mashiach, is in order not to interfere with the free will of people. In other words, once upon a time, people were on the level to witness this, and perhaps they will no longer be. I'm not sure if he said it, but if he did, I would like to say he said it for the following three reasons. He did not mean to say there will not be any at all. He possibly meant to say as follows. Right before Mashiach comes, there will be a tremendous hester panim. Hester panim means that Hashem will hide his face. It's a description of a situation where it is not so obvious that there is a creator in the world. In other words, before Mashiach comes, there will be a lot of darkness. Emunah will be something very difficult to come by. In other words, to believe in. People will believe more in science than they believe in creation. So therefore, because of this hester, it will just not be observed. People will not think of it as being something like that. That's one possibility. A second possibility of why he said there will not be so many dibukim is very possible because there will not be in the generation before Mashiach individuals who are capable of helping this dibuk achieve a tikkun. Mekubalim, Kabbalists who know what to do. There will be less of them. Therefore, they will not go searching for such a tikkun. But I think number three is also a big possibility. Number three is what I said before, that many of these dibukim are anonymous. They don't identify themselves. I am so and so. Here, I am a dibuk. They don't present themselves. They don't talk. They just stay where they are. They stay put. And the people who, of course, who have it suffer, whether they suffer a little bit or a lot, I guess depends on the dibuk. And by the way, there are good dibukim too. But that we're not going to get into too much tonight because it's a little bit of a different topic. A good dibuk is basically one that does not do any harm. It is a spirit of a righteous person, of a tzaddik, that temporarily enters the body of another human being for a limited amount of time and for a certain purpose, to achieve something itself or to do a favor to the person that it is possessing. So that's something else. But usually, the bad dibukim, the negative ones, the ones that are searching for a tikkun, it is possible that they may remain dormant for a number of years. And that individual who's possessed may or may not even know it. And that is why, possibly the Chafetz Chaim said, that we will not see too much of this. Even in the past, it was not every Monday and Thursday that you had a dibuk. It occurred once in a while, but it occurred almost in every culture and people were aware of these things in the past. They knew these things exist. Today you don't hear about it. It does not mean that it does not exist. It is very possibly in existence, just so we're not aware of it. Why don't people believe in it? It's not only because this is a more materialistic world that we live in, and people would rather just believe something that they can see with their own eyes. It's more than that. We're talking about a certain attitude in people. Those who are true believers don't need that much proof. Those who do not want to believe, you bring them all the proof in the world and they will still not be convinced. You show them the splitting of the Red Sea and they will tell you, you know why the Red Sea split? Because we're talking about low tide. This is the time of low tide. They'll explain anything that is really miraculous in a natural way. And that's why it's going to be very difficult for you to convince those who really don't want to believe. I once explained that the Midrash talks about the many, many Jews who died in the plague of darkness, Makat Choshech in Mitzrayim. They did not want to leave Egypt. And they died in the plague of darkness. Which plague is darkness in the order of 10 plagues? Which one is it? We have 10 altogether, right? Choshech is which plague? No, which number? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which one is Choshech? Number 9. The last one is Makat Bechorot, the plague of the firstborn. They died in which plague? Plague of darkness, number 9. Even though the Midrash does explain that the reason why they died in the plague of darkness then is so that the Egyptians should not see that Jews are dying too. All right. What I suggested perhaps was for another reason. You know why they died in plague number 9? They should have died in plague number 2, 3, 4. There were other plagues that were also very, very destructive, were killers. Hashem perhaps wanted them to see all the other plagues, witness them. Maybe you'll change your mind. And you'll realize I'm the boss and I'm the one that's taking you out as I promised I would. This is for real. This is not just a made-up dream, a wish of Moshe Rabbeinu. This is my instructions And if you don't believe me, I'm going to demonstrate to you, prove to you who's in charge here. They had 8 chances. And of course they didn't change their mind, so they died in the plague of darkness. They died at the very, very end. Just another explanation as why Hashem waited so much. Give them a chance to see. And before Mashiach, our tradition is that people will receive many chances to do teshuvah, to see for themselves that Hashem is in charge. Many things will happen in stages, that if people open their eyes, as long as they're not sleeping, they will be able to see and convince themselves, hopefully, hey, this is happening. Mashiach is really coming. How do you know? All the prophecies are being fulfilled. We're back in Israel. We're back home. Do you know that as of Rosh Hashanah, 5759 this year, there are more Jews living in Israel than in any other country in the world, including the United States of America, for the first time in the 2,000 years. Yes, about 6 million Jews, give or take, living in Israel today, where you only had 10,000 at the turn of the 20th century. 10,000 Jews. Now you have about 6 million. Now, we had close to 6 million in this country about 20 years ago, I think. But there's a lot of assimilation, unfortunately, intermarriage. So they're saying that there's only 5.2, 5.5 of them. There's not 6 million here anymore, unfortunately. Many Jews have moved out. So we're seeing many prophecies come true. Everything is coming true. And what's happening to the world and what's going to happen, if people pay attention, they will notice that something is about to happen. And hopefully that will awaken them. So Hashem will do His best to awaken us, but it still will be up to us. It will be always left to us to take those signals as His way of reaching out to us. But whether we reach on to Him or not, that of course will depend on us. Many people have reached out. There are many people who have done teshuvah. There are hundreds of thousands of people all over the world who are coming closer to their roots and beginning to live a more observant life. Obviously, investing more in Judaism, sending their kids to Jewish schools, becoming more familiar with their tradition, it is happening. So something is working. But does it mean that everybody will? Well, I hope everybody does. Because everybody is being given a fair chance. But now, unfortunately, not everybody is paying attention. So Dibukim was one way to awaken people. When somebody saw a Dibuk, hopefully he was shocked. And he did something about it. And there may be other similar things in the very, very near future that will have a similar effect. Okay, so we've covered Dibukim. Now just briefly, a few minutes, we'll go over to ghosts. What are ghosts exactly? You know, there's not that much information about ghosts anywhere. There are stories, eyewitnesses who have seen them, who see them all the time. There are haunted homes with ghosts. But people really don't understand the dynamics of what is a ghost, because after all, it doesn't make sense. Either you are a living human being, or you are dead in the grave. And once the body is in the grave, the soul should be either Gan Eden, Genom, and what did we just say till now? Kaf HaKela, perhaps. But when you're in the Kaf HaKela, you're a ghost? I mean, what? We didn't talk about that. All we said was anybody who's in the Kaf HaKela is so busy by being pursued, he has no peace. He doesn't just show up. Right? And if he possesses a body, then there's a different symptom. So what is all this apparitions of ghostly figures or figurines, men or women, appearing? Do you know that Lincoln's ghost has been seen in the White House several times? Lincoln himself knocking on the door. And we're talking about eyewitnesses who slept there in the White House. People who are trustworthy. I mean, you can trust them that they're saying the truth. So there are many, many places in America and elsewhere of observations of ghosts. So what is it all about? What we do know is as follows. For the first 12 months after the neshama leaves the physical body, when I say neshama, I interchange it with nefesh. because it's really the nefesh we're talking about, the living spirit. When it leaves the human body, for the first 12 months, it's very attached to this physical world. If we had spiritual eyes to see, we would see them on the grave for the entire 12 months, the first year after they leave this world. I did explain in the past that there's several parts. There is a neshama and the ruach. And they eventually, each one goes to a different spot. One goes to Gan Eden Alion, one goes to Gan Eden Atachton. There's different Gan Eden, one upstairs, one down here. They all go different places, the different parts of the soul. But the soul that we're talking about, the nefesh, which is the closest to the physical body, that remains in this physical world at least for 12 months. After 12 months, it joins the other parts of it, of itself, in a limited way. But there will always be a portion of that nefesh that will remain in the grave, especially if the bones are still there. Because after a while, the body decomposes. All that's left is the bones. Sometimes the bones are gone. Sometimes the bones are taken to somewhere else. So as long as there's something there, there will be a presence, a spiritual presence, or whatever it belonged to. In other words, the nefesh. It is very possible that there are many places that used to be cemeteries or where the dead were buried that we are unaware of. There could be even one underneath this street. An Indian cemetery from 900 years ago. How are you going to ever know? Unless you dug a lot. And they do occasionally find bones. They do occasionally find old cemeteries. So it is very possible that there is some presence from the past still around here. Okay, that's fine. But why should I be able to see them? You know, it's okay if I see the bones. Okay, fine. We'll put them back. But why should I be able to see them? Why do they come sometimes? Why do they make themselves so apparent? So before I get into this a little bit more in detail, I want to remind you we're not talking about demons, okay? We're talking about ghosts. We're talking about the disembodied spirit of somebody that used to be alive. Demons was something completely different, because there are demons, and they look different, and it's a whole different subject. We're talking about real spirits of real human beings. It turns out that if you study all the cases of ghosts, what they have in common many times is that these are spirits that for some reason do not have complete rest. They have not found they have not gone to their final resting place for whatever reason, and there's a variety of reasons. Number two, many of them have been killed or murdered. And usually we're talking about many of these who did not deserve to die. But it could be others who did deserve to die as well. And number three, that sometimes a ghost does come or does appear for a certain shlichut. It does come for some mission. It does come to do something. Now sometimes when they come for a mission, they don't only come as a ghost, they actually appear and they look to us in real human flesh. Hey, I thought you were dead. Yeah, I am. But I, you know, it came for some purpose. Yeah. This has happened from time to time. And it's incredible. My grandfather himself, Alav Shalom, told his kids that one day he's going up to, he took a bus in Israel. And all of a sudden, he sees his mother, who had already passed away 10 years ago. I mean, he knew how his mother looks like. It couldn't be, you know, some people look alike. This was his mother who had passed away 10 years ago. I believe it was 10 years ago when he saw her. Same scarf, the exact same scarf. So he sat down next to her. He starts talking to her. You know, so, oh, what are you doing here? How are you? And she doesn't answer. Doesn't talk to him at all. All right. You know, eventually the bus stops. So this woman, his mother, gets up, goes down. So he follows her. So he goes down after her and she just disappeared. What's that? No explanation given. From time to time, these souls do come down, either as a ghost or in more human form. Sometimes they speak to us, sometimes they don't. But there's something obviously behind this. They don't just decide, I want to take a ride, I want to come down for a visit. No, these things don't happen because even in a dream, they don't allow souls to appear just for that, for any reason, and to say what they have to say. They're not even allowed to disclose just anything they want to. They don't have the permission. So when these things happen, they obviously happen for a reason. It sometimes happens that you may be in a room or in a place where you see something passing, but you didn't catch it, but you knew something was there. There are always things around us. Most of the time we don't see them because Hashem does not want us to see these things, because we would go crazy, the rabbis tell us, if we would be able to see everything there is to see. Just imagine if you would be able to see bacteria all around you without microscopes. It'd be all over the place. You know how many germs, bacteria, in the air, in the floor, everywhere. You'd go crazy. So the rabbis tell us Hashem did us a favor that we, with our physical eyes, cannot see everything. Baruch Hashem, otherwise it would be hard for us to live. But from time to time, we do see. And there could be that there are places in this world where for some reason there are more spirits or ghostly apparitions in that spot because of some major event that occurred there. I'll give you an example. In England, England is known to have many of such incidents. There is a road in England, a very narrow road, where people have had many such incidents. A guy says, I once picked up somebody, gave him a ride. He asked me for a cigarette. He was sitting in the back seat. I got the cigarette out for him, and he's no longer there. I stopped the car, ran out. Perhaps he fell out. Couldn't find anything. Another guy says he ran over a young woman. And he picked her up. She was still alive. Covered her up with a blanket. Put her on the side of the road to call the ambulance. He went to call the ambulance. By the time he went back, there was no more girl there. Just a blanket. Many such stories. Not one, too many. In that same road. So the English investigated what happened in this place. Perhaps something happened there. And it turns out that in the 15th or 16th, I think it was the 16th century, in the 1500s, many people were hanged along that road. Hanged in the gallows. You know, the English used to do a lot of that, just to hang. For any reason, they hung. So who knows? It's possible that because of that, some of these souls did not have complete rest, or they had some attachment to that particular spot. And from time to time, that portion of the soul that is still in the grave, remember, would somehow appear. And would appear only because this was a spot. We don't walk in every day on a spot that is full of graves, especially graves of those who were killed. That's why we don't see them. But if you were to go to an area where a lot of that happened, it's possible you occasionally would come across it, especially if that soul for some reason has no rest. Now let me give an example of another soul which is very unusual, a Jewish soul that was a ghost. A Jewish ghost, yes. Not too long ago, I don't remember how many years ago, maybe 50 years ago, there was a single man who was an older man. He was single, he never got married. But he was a Talmid Chacham. Well, he was given a room in someone's home to study, to stay and to study, to live there. That's where he stayed all the years. He eventually passed away. He was an old man. Passed away with never having gotten married, no children. All right. One day the child goes into that same room where this man used to learn, and all of a sudden he sees his apparition exactly in the same way while he was alive, leaning over a Gemara and learning. And he got scared and ran out and told his father. The father, Baruch Hashem, was much more composed. In other words, he realized that these things happen. And he went into the room, and sure enough, he sees him too. He says, I'd like to ask you a favor to please not come back anymore. You are scaring my children. And ever since he said that, that apparition didn't come back anymore. But for a while, it was there. And there are other similar stories in the Talmud of those who have departed who came back to make Kiddush. And the like, stories that are similar. Whether it was a ghostly figure or not, I don't know. But something came back For what reason also, we don't know. This individual, perhaps, if you ask, what was he doing in that room? I mean, he should be in Gan Eden, he was a Talmid Chacham, he was learning Torah. What should he be? I mean, he left. Remember what I said before, there's a small detail that perhaps gives away the reason. He was never married, never had children. There's no continuation. Something is lacking. He's not at peace with himself completely. What this man did not know, I'm not gonna blame him for anything, the owner of the home, is that very possibly the reason for the apparition altogether was that he wanted a tikkun. Listen, I have nothing. Do something for me. That's what I think. I mean, otherwise, why should he come just to appear? Oh, I miss this place so much. I mean, you should be in a different place altogether. This is not a cemetery. What was he doing in that room? What's his connection to that room? It could be he needed the tikkun. And instead of coming as a dibuk, as we said before, comes back as an apparition. A lot of these ghosts, I was told, I saw it somewhere, that as long as the murderer is not caught, they don't have rest. They're not at peace. That may be another reason. There's something that is disturbing them, something that is attaching them to that particular spot where they are, especially if that is close to where they are buried. What about those who were killed al Kiddush Hashem? Just like to say a word or two about that, since unfortunately we had the terrible tragedy in the past week in India, where a young couple and some other Jews lost their life. And this is, of course, al-Kiddush Hashem, because they were Jewish. Kiddush Hashem, to sanctify God's name, has always been one of the greatest mitzvot. It is a tremendous act, the act of self-sacrifice, the act of giving one's life for what you believe in. And there's no doubt that all those who die al-Kiddush Hashem are on a very, very high level. The rabbis tell us that you actually need to have a zechut, a merit, to die al Kiddush Hashem. You don't get to die, even if you want to, al Kiddush Hashem, unless you have the merits to die al Kiddush Hashem. We know that Kiddush Hashem is a big tikkun. Whoever went through it, for whatever reason, is also a big tikkun. And in Gan Eden, there's a special department, a special machlaka, for all those who die al Kiddush Hashem, that nobody else can enter there. So obviously, it is something which we don't fully understand why it needs to happen that way, but it has happened throughout our history in many, many ways, whether it was in Spain or in Portugal or under various circumstances that people gave their lives. And there's no doubt about it that this is a tremendous Kiddush Hashem, in other words, Hashem's name being sanctified, and that their soul is in a very, very special place. We here are in great pain because of the loss, but in reality, for them, they are in the highest possible place that one can be. And what's interesting is that sometimes a person can get there in 1 second. People work a whole lifetime to get there, performing mitzvot, being very observant, being very careful. And here is somebody who, because they died for what they believe in, they were able to get there in 1 second. It is actually harder to live a life of Kiddush Hashem than to give your life on Kiddush Hashem. Because to give your life, it takes 1 second. To live a life of a Jew, of an observant Jew, al Kiddush Hashem, sanctifying God's name on a daily basis, on the regular, that is much more difficult. So when somebody is able to get there quickly, it is tremendous zechut. Just want to add two more points. It is very, very important to keep in mind that if you know anybody who wants to cremate his spouse, his relative, you should stop them from doing that. They obviously maybe want to save some money because the cremated body only takes up a few inches. I don't know what they want to do, but it is a terrible crime. It is forbidden. When somebody does that, it shows that he does not believe in hasharat ha-nefesh, in the survival of the soul, in tchiyat ha-metim, that the dead eventually will rise. It's a tremendous tikkun for the dead to decompose in the ground. As we explained earlier, it is important for that med, therefore, to be buried in the earth, not in ashes, but as a full body. Obviously, if somebody died in the Holocaust, in Auschwitz, that is a whole different chapter. It is still a mitzvah to bury the ashes if you have them. So if anybody was cremated against the halacha, against the Jewish tradition, you should still take the ashes and bury them and not put them in the living room for everybody to see. This is your dad's ashes. No. That is also a zilzul in the kavod of the met. It is a way of it's a disgrace of the dignity of the dead person too. And believe me, that in the upper world, if he can speak to us, he would tell us that it was a terrible thing to do. If he could call back, don't do it, he would tell us, don't do it. But he can't anymore. So even if he instructs you to do so, don't do so. You don't have to do so. The problem is when the family wants it, and you as an outsider say no, then you're going to have a difficult time. But if there's any way that you can stop the cremation of a Jew, you should stop it. We've spoken about the various stages that a dead person goes through. I'd like to just finish with the tikkun. What can one do for those who are deceased? They're no longer here. They can no longer do anything for themselves. We, as their children, or not even their children, even as other Jews, we're all arevim ze laze. We're all responsible for each other. We're all one big family. We can all do for each other. And we can all do for those who have left this world. The Kaddish is very important. Obviously, the Kaddish of a son is even more important than the Kaddish than somebody else says. But if there are no sons, the daughters don't say it. You should hire somebody that you know that you can rely on him, that he will say it for the entire 11 months or so. And during the Yortzeit, the Kaddish is very important. Learning Mishnayot is also traditionally something that is very helpful for the Neshama. Neshama and Mishnah are the same letters. Learning any Torah for the deceased is important, but especially Mishnayot, Tehillim, lighting a candle, giving tzedakah, saying a blessing over foods that we customarily do on the Yortzeit. All of these are beautiful things that one can easily do, and it'd be a tremendous help for the neshama. But what most people forget, that the greatest tikkun of all, that the greatest tikkun that will bring the most nachat, the most happiness to the deceased soul, is when the children continue to go b'derech haTorah. If the children do not behave themselves, that brings the most agony and pain to the soul, because it is aware of what's going on with its children down here. It may not know everything that's going on in the world, but it definitely knows about its children and grandchildren. So therefore, it pains them to see that they have no more control over them, and they cannot say anything to them. And it would also please them greatly to see that their children, the ones that they left behind, their representatives, their continuation in this world is going in the right path. That, Bezat Hashem, will bring the greatest nachat. The true nachat that we have while we are alive is to see our kids behave themselves. But even after we leave this world, we still can have nachat. True nachat is Jewish nachat, as we call it in Yiddish, Yiddish nachas. Not that they have a good career, they have a job, they have a home and a car. The American dream is not Jewish nachat. Jewish nachat that really, really pleases the neshamot upstairs is when they see that their kids continue to be Jewish. Thank you.